In the year 1962, there was a sense that something big was about to happen in Central Florida. Tupperware had just opened its world headquarters. The northern extension of the Florida Turnpike was nearing completion. The Lake Eola Amphitheater was about to celebrate its grand opening. The man who shot Liberty Valance was playing at the Colony Theater in Winter Park. Colonial Plaza had just recently enclosed to create one of the country's first indoor shopping malls. Interstate 4 had just been finished, and the Parliament House Motor Inn opened to the public. The 120-room hotel was the first in a chain of what was to become 8 Parliament House hotels throughout the country. Then, in 1972, the Walt Disney World Resort opened to the public, and hundreds of hotels and motels opened nearby, forever changing the habits of vacationing families who visited Orlando. Occupancy at the Parliament House Motor Inn dropped substantially, and the area that surrounded it became frequented by prostitutes. Contemplating bankruptcy, the hotel owners were approached by Mike Hodge and Bill Miller, who made them an offer, and the rest is our history.
I met Bill and Michael at this first bar that they owned, which was in Indian River City, which is now part of Titusville, quite honestly. And that would have been when I had to be probably 20 or 21 years old.
So Bill Miller was truly the business head of the Parliament House. Michael Hodge then was the personality, if that can make any sense.
And Michael called me one day and said, "Do you know anything about the Parliament House?" And I said, "Well, in fact, I do." And he goes, "And how would you know anything about the Parliament House?" I said, "Well, my actuality is that I work right down the street from it at Hertz Truck Rental, where I'm a sales manager. And the staff and my associates go there to meet the prostitutes that are there for happy hour every afternoon." He goes, "Oh my God." He says, "Well, that is what it is about." I said, "Oh yes, it definitely is what it is about." He says, "Well, Bill and I, are considering purchasing this property. What do you think that would be, and how do you think it would be as a gay destination?" I said, "Oh my God, I think it'd be fabulous. Obviously, we don't have anything like it. You have a great bar downtown, the Diamond Head, but it certainly does not offer all that could be offered in that facility there."
The police, of course, you know, they really, I don't think they really catered to the idea of a place like that opening up in this town.
You couldn't sit with your hands under the bar. You had to have them on top of the bar. You couldn't dance touching each other. That's how disco was born, was because of gay people. They couldn't touch in the bars, so it was always, usually in straight bars, because I worked in straight bars, songs, bands played the songs. It was two fast songs, a slow song, two fast songs, a slow song. But in gay bars, it had to be fast songs all night long. Maybe the last one they'd sneak in a slow song where you could hug your honey or whatever.
And we used to have to keep onto the people operating the switchboard, that they couldn't listen into conversations because it had one of those old pull and plug things in. So somebody bring in a call would come in, the switchboard would answer it, and they'd have to plug it into a room. But they could listen in on that conversation, so we had to keep getting in on.
The first time I went to the Parliament House was 1976, and I was 16 years old. This was long before Mothers Against Drunk Driving. So first of all, the drinking age was 18. And second of all, they didn't care back then. I had an ID that I sent away for from the back of Mad Magazine that they sent me, and the Parliament House just didn't care and took it. And so the bar was full of 16-year-olds, quite frankly.
Well, you know, in the early days at the Parliament House, the front entry was not closed off, and you drove through. It was a one-way drive. You drove in from Orange Blossom Trail down through. The pool was on your right side, and you swerved around and went around the back and came around. Well, let me assure you that in those times, that was the best cruising spot in Orlando. What would happen is you would come and you would drive through. You would see who's there, who's lurking about, decide whether you were going through for a second trip or not, or if you were going to just stop and enjoy yourself. That was a great thing.
And the show bar, of course, was where it is, but it was all one floor then. When you opened the door where the piano bar is now, it went all the way back to the back of the room. It used to be where they had conventions years ago, and you could even see the louvered doors where they would pull them to make the rooms bigger or smaller.
Bill would run around, and we'd want to put together a show there, and he would say, how much is this going to cost? And for example, he saw one time I took some cardboard boxes and some jewelry and made all of these fantastic-looking belts and things out of, and the first thing out of his mouth was, how much is that going to cost him? And I said, it costs you two Jim Beam cardboard boxes out of your liquor room.
When you first walked in to the disco, there were lots of tables and chairs there for the girls. You know, when you have tables and chairs, you're going to have lesbians. They like to sit and nest.
I remember specifically them taking me into what was to be the disco, and for them to show me the first light show that they had designed to place in there. And in actuality, that at that point in time, the dance floor was over against what is now the pool bar. And it was like this semicircle in the ceiling. And honest to God, it was nothing but tinfoil and Christmas lights. That was our first original disco show, a light show there in the Parliament House.
The guys would walk up and go, can I have a slow gin fizz? Would go, Navy. It was just funny because those kids were off they were right off of the farm, some of them, and all they knew to order was what they had seen in the movies, you know. And they tended to order more foo-foo drinks. So we had a lot of fun with that and picking and choosing where they came from.
George would be on had the turntables, and my shoulders were bumping against his, especially when we had the Friday night, what is it, Thank God It's Friday DJ booth that was shaped like that DJ booth from Thank God It's Friday, mirrors on the outside, supposed to look like our heads were popping out of a diamond or a spaceship or something. The lights that I would control were switches, I had light switches, and if the music would get soft, I'd have to turn on the heavy lights up above, because you could hear them. It was, so you know, you had to be careful with that.
Michael Hodge was originally arrested for spanking somebody on the butt in the bathroom at the Parliament House. And I remember he had to be bailed out.
But everyone that worked there had to come in once a week. Bartenders, bar backs, anybody that was on staff, not in the show, but anybody that was on staff had to come in once a week, and the bartenders would clean the bar. And bar backs, which when I was bar backing and working in the DJ booth was tons of work, but Jimbo did most of it, because I, once a week, had to clean all the lights in the ceiling. And if you look up even today, well, today I'm sure they don't do that. But I had to clean all that tar and nicotine stuck to the ceiling off, stuck to the lights. I had to clean every light. It took maybe 5 hours at least.
My first time at the Parliament House was, I think, 1977 or 78, and a group of people I worked with at Arthur Murray's brought me there to see a show, and it was a Rocky Horror tribute kind of a show. And I will never forget, they were doing the table scene where in the movie, you know, it's Meatloaf and they're eating him. And in this version, all of the queens were sitting around a big table, and they brought out a huge silver platter with a dome on it. When they opened it up, there was a baby on the platter, and they all simultaneously reached, and each took a different limb of the baby doll and pulled on it so that all the arms and the legs and the head came off, and they had stuffed the baby with spaghetti and marinara sauce. And so it all came out, and they were all sucking the innards of the baby out while a spotlight came on, and Lori Del Mar came out and sang Baby Love to lip-syncing to Diana Ross.
I remember the first drag number I saw was Rusty Fawcett doing Don't It Make Your Brown Eyes Blue in one of those big rattan fanback chairs. It was the 70s. I mean, people in silky shirts and pocketless pants and big bell bottoms and lots of polyester and lots of fun.
When I first approached Bill Miller about bringing my first show there, David's Time, I thought that a selling point was that I had already spoken to the newspapers and the theater critics had agreed that they would come and review the shows. And he says, well, stop right there, Michael. He goes, you know, I'm happy to give you the theater. He goes, but this is not a selling point. And the issue was that the times were just so different back then and so dangerous back then that publicity, even positive publicity, was not desirable. And Bill thought that publicity just reminded the mainstream general public that the Parliament House was there and that that put the patrons in danger.
And P was the greatest entertainer. And even though P lived at the Parliament House, P was somebody that we weren't. You know, nobody was close to. P was at a distance. P lived in his own space in the back facing the lake with his show tune albums and books.
P was an excellent MC. Paul would get out there and start rapping about anything, and I would be backstage, and I'm the stickler for looking at my watch and looking out there at Paul, and you'd hear him occasionally say, well, Geraldine's giving me a bad look, that means that I've been out here too long, etc. But he would keep the audience really, really hyped up, and the people would come out, and they were extremely grateful.
He didn't realize that people came to the Parliament House to see him. He was very humble that way. He knew that it was the whole show, that people came to see the whole show. But very rarely did people come through the front door and ask if somebody else in the show was working. It was always, is P here tonight? Is P going to be working? Because he was very unique.
And I said, good evening, P. And she said to me, I'm not P. My name is Paul Wegman. I won't be P until later.
Paul would do a number from Pippin's. In no time at all, that he'd take his dentures out. And Paul would take his dentures out, and I'm standing backstage, and he'd hand them to me just like you're handing a wallet there. Hold on to this till I finish. And I'm, what? You know, after the first time, I got accustomed to it. But it was so strange.
A lot of the employees lived at the Parliament House. I lived at the Parliament House for about 6 months when I got kicked out of an apartment I was living in with some friends for lack of paying rent. So I lived there on the Grove side because that parking lot used to be in Orange Grove. And I lived in a room for about 6 months, and that was an experience. There were lots of employees that lived there that literally never left the property for huge lengths of time. I mean, they ate at the restaurant, they went to the bar, and they lived in their room.
I had decided to move to New Orleans. I did it. I planned to do it. I set a date, August 13th, 1983. I was going to leave. And as the date approached for me to move, I started thinking, well, maybe I won't do this. I had told people I didn't think I was going to be able to go through with it, that I was going to stay. And I can't remember who told me, but somebody said, P wants to talk to you. And the gist of the conversation was, John Barber, I understand you're thinking that you might stay and not leave. And I said, oh, I'm just so comfortable and safe here. I can't believe I was talking to P. It was Paul. It was amazing. And he chewed me out and basically told me that if I I wish I could say it the way he did, but he told me if I didn't leave now, if I didn't go, that I would regret it the rest of my life, and that I would end up being an old, bitter queen, and still living in Orlando. And I think he said living at the Parliament House. Back then, we didn't know you wouldn't be able to live there forever.
Oh, one of the biggest challenges during the 1980s were AIDS and the effect that it had on the community. Our business, of course, went down, but that wasn't the worst part. The worst part was that our friends were dying, and we were going to, like, a funeral a week.
Why, so we were sad a lot.
I quit counting when I got to 130.
So many of my peripheral friends, or people that I physically admired, the beautiful people, I saw dwindling away and becoming ill. And I'm like, oh my gosh, what is going on here? This is a devastating thing.
You would go, and there was like people you didn't necessarily know, but they were sort of people you saw around the bar a lot, and then they just suddenly weren't there. And you would ask somebody, hey, where's so-and-so? And they went, oh, he died. And that was back when it came quickly. I mean, I remember friends finding out they had it and dying within 3 months. And you were just like, suddenly this person that you hung out with all the time at the bar was just not there.
And I remember, you know, back during the AIDS scare, before there was the Hope and Help, before there was a Centaur, there was just a group of Parliament House regulars, along with Bill Miller and Mike Hodge, who decided something had to be done to help out the people who were unable to work and at that time had no programs of assistance available to them. And they started something called Aid Orlando. And I'm not sure that, I don't know that they ever filed papers or that it was ever an actual nonprofit or that there was a board. They decided there was no time for that. And so they just started raising money and paying people's electric bills and paying people's rent and getting people goods and services, including just feeding people who literally couldn't feed themselves and had nowhere else to turn. They did fundraisers all the time, but I know for a fact that when the money wasn't there, these guys, McAdoo, Mish G, Ron Stoddard, and of course the owners of the Parliament House, dug into their own pockets many times, and then by example, other people followed. And
Bill and Michael were amazing pioneers to move our gay community in Orlando, Florida, to a place that it would probably never have been if it had not been for them. And they were very good to us. I mean, I was telling you that we had the Aid Orlando organization. If it had not been for those two individuals and their pressure on other bar owners in the Orlando area, it would have had a bumpy start. It would have not been near so well-funded.
After Bill Miller died, the estate was, of course, taxed. So half of the value of the Parliament House at that time was taxed due to, for inheritance taxes. So all that had to be paid while Michael was still alive.
Because he and Bill had made all the decisions together and sometimes had called me at 2 or 3 in the morning. I remember not long after Bill died, he called at 3 o'clock in the morning. He was all upset. And I said, what's the matter with you? He says, well, you know, Bill never wanted to advertise in such and such magazine, and I just took out an ad in that. And I said, honey, all those years you did what Bill wanted you to do. You respected his wishes, but now you're doing what's good for the business, and advertising in that magazine is going to help us. But after he died, he left the bar to his family and his older brother, and he told Sam, keep us open, keep it gay, and keep all of us working.
You almost immediately saw things to be dramatically different than they had been prior. And I just mean in the way things were taken care of.
Floating away. The place was just existing. You know, it had lost some of the fire that it had to it.
Speculation that it was being sold or being sold to somebody from Tampa or not going to be a gay bar anymore or
all sorts of rumors floating around, you're correct, about whom might purchase the Parliament House from the Hodge family, being that they had just been sort of left with it. But none of them ever came to fruition, really. And then, of course, the rumors started flying about the Canadian couple coming.
And when we came here, we heard about the Parliament House. Had no idea what it was whatsoever.
I really didn't know what to think. I thought it was kind of odd that all these straight couples were coming in to buy a gay resort, but I didn't really think too much of it, to be honest.
Then we talked to people in other cities that we knew in the community, and they all knew the Parliament House, which was an amazing thing to us. And we asked them, do you go to the Parliament House? The answer was invariably no. And we say, why not? They say, well, it's run down and a bit of a whorehouse, to be quite blunt about it. But I said, but all of you know it. They said, yeah, would you come back if we fixed it? Was the end. And the answer was always yes.
I hoped that the Parliament House would stay, would remain the haven for wayward boys and girls that it was.
And the day we arrived to take a look at the property was the shock of our lives. There was no courtyard, it was parking. And we arrived, no other cars were there, and this cute little boy comes running out of the bear den. Do you know where you are? And we said, yeah. Do you know that this is a gay place? The two of us looked at each other. Remember that?
I do. It was an interesting first look.
So Susan came up with a glass brick wall that was put up there that made the whole place much more private than what it had been before, which was probably the best thing that ever could have been done.
And that was a big, big change, because all of a sudden they had all of this space and everything. And I came out one day, and there's Susan with about 13 people working in the garden, 13 gentlemen. And I'm going, where'd you get all the helpers? I said, did you go to the labor force? She said, no. I said, who's digging in our gardens? She said, customers. I said, customers? She said, they came from the rooms, they want to help. And I thought that was unbelievable. We started realizing what we were doing through this renovation. It gave me a little bit of goosebumps, because everybody was thanking us. Instead of saying, this looks pretty, like we normally get whenever we've done anything, everybody was going, thank you for making the place right.
They made great decisions right from the very start that were simple and didn't cost a whole lot of money and just changed the whole atmosphere of the bar.
For the millennial celebration, P decided that she would be dropped off in the courtyard by a helicopter.
We wanted to do something very dramatic, and we discussed it, and somebody came up with the idea of having a helicopter drop Miss P into the courtyard at 12 midnight. And sure enough, Miss P was very willing to do this.
He did tell me that he was frightened to death.
Well, we bought the place. I mean, the thing we were told, you'll never have a problem as long as you got Miss P. So naturally, 1 year later, she tells us she's retiring. That was a very strange moment for us. And Darcelle, who we asked to be the MC to help, she said she doesn't want to do that. And we said, please take the mic. She took it, and she won't give it back. We know that. She hasn't stopped talking since.
Hurricane Charlie scared everybody. It came through fast and did a lot of destruction. Well, I came down the street after the hurricane, and that I saw the sign gone, and I was heartbroken.
We were told that unless there was certain repairs made in a relatively short period of time, that we could not use the size sign again. So we contracted this company to do this vinyl thing that we put over, which was exactly the logo of the Parliament House, until they had reconstructed the sign a year later.
It's interesting that 20 some odd years later, Don and Susan, when they bought the Parliament House and they spoke to me about doing theater there. They wanted theater there for the exact opposite reasons that Bill begrudgingly agreed to let me do theater there. They wanted the publicity. The times had changed, and they thought the important thing to do was to make sure that the Parliament House started having a better image in the local community. So they embraced the idea of doing theater there. As a matter of fact, Susan is crazed in whether if there's a dark night in the theater now.
There are a lot of shows that would not have been produced anyplace else than the Parliament House. I mean, they probably would be in now, but back then, Boys in the Band could not have been done anyplace else but the Parliament House. Bent probably could not have been done anyplace else but the Parliament House.
And that's one thing about the Parliament House. There is always something for everybody there. The Parliament House is what you make it.
There are certain individuals there. The service that is provided by those, the friendship that is provided by those.
The thing is, Parliament House is our life. It's not a place we go to work or anything else. I don't know where I'd go anymore. That's really the truth. And we have tenacity. We're not quitters anyway, never have been.
Well, the Parliament House was an amazing stimulator of fundraisers. They would, if you went to them with a purpose, a desire, and a need that was going to help the gay community in Orlando, you could almost bank your support on their support on it.
It's funny how, for such a long time, people in the mainstream community looked at the Parliament House as this blight on the area and on the community at large. But now, indisputably, it's the Parliament House that is the impetus behind what is going to be the resurgence or the renaissance of that little section of Orange Blossom Trail.
Finally, what was going to happen in 2009 is the city is embracing Orange Blossom Trail, which makes a major difference. Now, that to somebody, that might sound like a good time to beat it. Well, all it means to us is that how do we develop this thing into something that everybody wants? And it's going to be a little more mainstream. When I say that, I don't mean straight. I mean that it's going to be more accepted. We're partnered with RCI, as Timeshare used to be. Now it's with the Parliament Vacation Club, the first gay vacation club being sold.
I think the thing that will ensure the Parliament House's longevity for just as long as those venerable buildings stand will be the fact that it's home. It's home to so many of us. It's not just steeped in history. It's steeped in emotional attachment. It's steeped in lifelong friendships and memories that are could not have been made anywhere else but there. It's evolved, it's changed, it's going to continue to evolve, but the thing that will keep it going is the fact that it's been a constant. No matter what else happens in Orlando, no matter what is happening in your personal life, your life outside the community, your life outside the bar, and you know, even people who criticize the Parliament House, they're there because it's always there and it's always going to be there.
Happy 40th anniversary, Parliament House.
Thank you for being there for the last 40 years because I've been able to work there for 35 years and I've had a wonderful time at the Parliament House. Parliament House is what you make it, and I've made it my home. I've made it my life's work. I've met so many great people there that are still friends 35 years later. And I'm glad that they're still there. And I thank Don and Susan for keeping it and keeping us open.
Well, I wish the Parliament House a very, very happy 40th anniversary. I appreciate it being a place for me to come and party with myself and my friends for us all of these years, for all 40 of the years. And it does present a great opportunity for our community to strengthen itself as a wonderful gay destination in the world.
Happy anniversary, Parliament House. Thank you for 40 years of entertainment and joy in my life. The 80s, I would go four times a week and for 10 years. And it was always a home for me and always knew I would see people I knew and loved and just, I have nothing but pleasant memories of that bar and the joy it's brought to my life. And
happy 40 years. I wish you 40 more. And I'm so glad to be back here living in Orlando. And I have a great time that every time I go back.
I like the wish Don and Susan well with what they've done with everything. And for the few of us that are still around here that knew that place when it started, happy 40th anniversary.
Happy 40th anniversary to the Parliament House. Mostly I want to say thank you and honor the memory of Bill Miller and Michael Hodge and all the people who were early participants at the Parliament House who, quite frankly, provided me with a theatrical career and a place to do my shows and a home for so many others. And I just hope that the kids of today will look at this video and have some appreciation for the people who came before them and the sacrifices they made. And thanks to Don and Susan for rescuing the place. And here's to the future.
Happy 40 years.
Happy 40th anniversary to the Parliament House, the best place on earth.
To all our customers and our friends, thank you.
Saturday, January the 9th, and we're gonna do a lot of shit for you, okay?
Oh, what is this song? I need it.